Hey y'all, my name is Prashanth Kumar, or PK, and I'm an MCAT tutor at Shemmassian Academic Consulting. Today, we're going to be doing 5 questions from the MCAT bio-biochem section, specifically the discrete questions. It should be taken roughly a minute and a half for each of these questions, but today, we're going to be going more in depth so you can see exactly what's going on in my head as I tackle each of these questions. Let's get it. All right, before we get started, make sure to like the video and subscribe to our channel and comment exactly what types of content or videos you want to see next on the channel. With that, let's get right into these 5 questions. So I've gone ahead and put them right here, but I'm going to go through it and zoom in so you guys get a better look at each of the questions. And so with that, feel free to take a moment and pause the video, go at it at your own pace, and come back to us. If not, let's get right into question number 1. For me, I like to think of the discrete questions as a blessing, right? It's really nice to not have to read a passage once again. And they're a nice respite after these long, oftentimes boring passages. And so I like to think, okay, so these are the ones that we're really going to want to finish quickly, okay? So the reason is we don't have to read a passage. If we only have to read a question, it should be question, answer almost immediately, or a little bit of calculation and get the answer immediately. So think of this as a faster paced question, maybe a minute to a minute and a half for each of these. But with that, we can get right into question number 1. Researchers are studying a potential novel oncoprotein implicated in gastric cancer, RT-qPCR. Results show an upregulation of the mRNA transcripts of the novel protein. Which of the following is a potential mechanism by which transcription of the protein is upregulated? Is it A, opening of chromatin structure, B, histone deacetylation, C, increased ribosome synthesis, or D, increased amino acid availability? All right, so the nice thing about these sort of discrete questions is that the question is the only thing we really need to focus on. We can read through it just to understand the details. Sometimes they might ask, but for the most part, the question is really the only thing we care about. So here, the question is mechanism for transcription of the protein being upregulated. Something simple, and we're just looking for an answer choice that will allow us to choose this. So right away, we're looking for something that increases transcription rates, right? And so that requires an understanding of what does transcription do, right? Transcription, I'll just call it TC, just so we don't get confused. That is the process of turning DNA into RNA, big picture. And then what is the counter of it? It's translation, right? It's the second step. And that is turning RNA to protein. And so this question is specifically asking about transcription, not translation, right? So anything dealing with DNA to RNA, we can focus on. But anything with RNA to protein, we don't really care about. And so right away, we see 2 answer choices we can eliminate because they're dealing with proteins. And that's C and D. We don't really care about ribosomes or amino acids because those are associated with protein creation. So right away, we're at a 50-50. Or we know it's down to A and B. So we should know that the way we increase transcription is we want more access to the DNA, right? That's the idea. Increased access to the DNA results in increased transcription. Okay? So there is an answer that looks pretty good right away, and that's A. Opening up chromatin structure is how we have more access to the DNA. And so the way we do this is by these biological modifications of acetylation and methylation, right? And so I am going to move this a little bit. Oops. I'm going to move this. I'm going to erase this for now. And so the reason I want to focus on this is because this is a very important idea. This idea of acetylation and methylation, okay? And then I'm also put a dash here, and then I put D here. And you'll see why in a second, right? So the reason is I want to say if we have normal acetylation, that means we're going to have increased transcription rates, okay? Transcription. Whereas if we have methylation of our DNA, we're going to have decreased transcription rates, right? And so if we are dealing with deacetylation, we're going to have decreased transcription rates. Whereas if we have demethylation, we're going to have increased transcription rates, right? And so this sort of like table I've created very loosely is exactly what we're thinking about when we're dealing with transcription, right? Remember, we're looking for something that will increase transcription rates by increasing access. And that would be, in this case, acetylation right here, or demethylation, not deacetylation. So we can eliminate B and we're left with A, right? Increase access to the DNA, whether it's through acetylation or demethylation, is the same idea of opening up the chromatin structure for more transcription to occur. And with that, we're one for one, right on to question number two. A red flower is mated with a white flower, resulting in pink progeny. This is an example of A, codominance, B, heterodominance, C, complete dominance, or D, incomplete dominance. All right, so a genetics question dealing with types of heritability. Right away, we should know these types of heritability off the top of our head very, very strongly. Okay, so codominance is this idea of both properties of the parents being assertively dominated together, right? It's going to be equally dominant in this situation. So the idea I always look at is we have a pink flower, right? And I'll actually do it with the colors this time, right? So we have this like red flower, and then we have a flower with black dots on it, right? And so when we put them together, we're going to have a red flower with black dots, okay? So we're going to see both traits equally expressed in this. And they're able to sort of cooperate together. Whereas heterodominance is a made-up term. It's not something we learned, so we're going to get rid of that. Complete dominance is, okay, we have this red, or I'm going to draw this arrow right here. And so we have this red and this black flower, for example, right? Only one of them will be able to be the more dominant one if they both are paired together, right? And so you're usually going to see the red flower 75% of the time. And then you can also see the black dotted flower 25% of the time. So this is assuming the red is the dominant, the black is the recessive. And so with that, we'd see a mix of both of them if we saw a bunch of them. So now incomplete dominance is this exact situation that we're looking for, right? I'll draw it in green down here. Incomplete dominance says, okay, let's start with a red flower and a white flower. We're gonna blend, I guess you can't see the white, but we're gonna blend these to make, so that's a better pink, we're gonna make a pink flower out of both of them. That's the common example we see, right? It's a blend somewhere in between 50% of the red and the white, pink. And so incomplete dominance is what we're gonna pick as our answer choice, not complete dominance and not codominance. People oftentimes get confused between codominance and incomplete dominance. I like to think codominance is a situation where both qualities are not moderated at all. They're put together and it's like a big mess together, right? Whereas incomplete dominance is like kind of the moderator. You're like in the middle of both qualities, whereas you're not strongly biased to either. Whereas codominance, you're kind of polarized and biased to both. All right, question number three. A non-diabetic individual eats a large carbohydrate-rich meal. Which of the following glycolysis enzymes is insulin most likely to upregulate? Is it A, phosphoglucose isomerase, B, phosphofructokinase, kinase, 1, C, phosphoglycerin mutase, D, enolase? All right, so the idea is we're just looking after a big meal, right, eating, which of the following glycolysis enzymes is insulin most likely to upregulate? So we know insulin causes an increase in glycolysis, right? We eat more food, we want to turn that into energy, so we're going to have increased glycolysis. And so the important part of this discrete question is not knowing necessarily each of the steps of glycolysis, but really one important detail, and that is the rate limiting step, okay? The rate limiting step is the step usually targeted by hormones or enzymes. And this is the step for which you increase or decrease the rates of something. That step is always targeted. And so in this case, we need to know the rate limiting step of glycolysis. And if there's one sort of enzyme I want you to know, it is phosphofructokinase. That's probably the most important one especially for glycolysis, and that is the rate limiting step for glycolysis. And so this will be the step that has regulated the flow through glycolysis by insulin. So insulin will target glycolysis, I'll write it in pink, via PFK1, okay? The other enzymes, not really important, right? They're part of the steps, but they're not the steps that are being regulated very, very heavily. They're not the rate limiting step. The rate limiting step is the step which is able to be monitored very, very heavily. All right, onward to question number three. I'll eliminate A, B, A, C, and D for that reason. Onward to question number four. Cells are treated with a drug that dissipates the proton gradient across the inner mitochondrial membrane. What is the net result? A, cancer progression is halted. B, ATP cannot be produced via ATP synthase. C, the cell will use exocytosis to dispose of the non-functional mitochondria. Or D, cells will rapidly evolve a new ATP synthesis mechanism. All right, so the idea is that we're dissipating proton gradient. These should be buzzwords that you're hearing in your head over and over again, right? Across the inner mitochondrial membrane, what is the net result? Okay, so we want to think, what is this inner mitochondrial membrane and what does it do? So when we're thinking mitochondria, powerhouse of the cell, what is it doing, right? It's related to protons and ATP synthase, right? As we're creating ATP, it's due to this proton gradient. So I'm right away thinking, proton gradient, ATP. So if we're dissipating the proton gradient, then we're going to have less ATP available. So I'm going to eliminate A and C almost immediately because they don't have anything to do with proton gradients or ATP. And so we're down to B and D. ATP cannot be produced via ATP synthase, or D, cells will rapidly evolve a new ATP synthesis mechanism. Right away, without even thinking about ATP synthase too much, we should know that cells won't be able to adapt that quickly if we just say, here's a drug. They're not going to create a new system of ATP synthesis right away. Rather, they're going to rely on glycolysis probably without the mitochondria. And so we can eliminate D because there's no new thing going to be evolved almost immediately. It takes time, decades, centuries, all of that. And so B is right away our biggest best answer. But let's just make sure we understand this, right? So we have our sort of membrane. I'm going to draw that as the inner membrane. And so as we go through our subunits, our H pluses are going across the membrane, okay? And so the whole point of the mitochondria is that when we're going from this matrix to this inner membrane space, we're just pumping out these protons into the inner membrane space from the matrix, or into the other way around, into the matrix from the inner membrane space, okay? And so the whole point is it's generated for this thing called ATP synthase, where we have a bunch of H pluses, and then the H pluses will build up on this side and pump back in to reach ADP, turn it into ATP. So this is the big picture idea, right? So that protons flow from the inner membrane space into the matrix. So I'll write this out. Interbrain space, matrix. Okay? So protons will pump out into the inner membrane space and then flow back in through ATP synthase to create ATP via ATP synthase. Sorry if I confuse you. It's starting from the matrix, pumping out to the inner membrane space, pumping back in. And so this is the big picture idea of why we're creating that proton gradient. So all of a sudden, if we have a drug that dissipates that, then there's not going to be enough in the inner membrane space to pump back in to the matrix or to create ATP. All right. With that, let's go on to our final question of today, five. Following a viral infection, a patient has not shown any respiratory symptoms or fever. What cycle is the virus most likely in? Is it A, lytic, B, lysogenic, C, invasion, or D, protein production? All right away, we should note that C and D are not types of viral cycles that we've heard of, right? The two main ones we've heard of are the lytic and the lysogenic cycle. And so the two things I want you to remember is lytic is more of the destroy immediately type of thing. And lysogenic is playing the long game, okay? And so if you're playing the long game, you want to ingrain yourself in the cell's DNA and then allow yourself to multiply for longer and longer time until something stressful happens and the cell goes haywire, okay? So I'll illustrate it in two ways, okay? So first, we'll start with the lysogenic cycle. This is the long game. And so a virus, I'll draw it with a green spiky, attacks the cell, and I'm going to draw a red little DNA, circular DNA. There. And so what happens is that this green joins into the red just here. All right, question number five. Following a viral infection, a patient is not showing any respiratory symptoms or fever. What cycle is the virus most likely in? Is it A, lytic, B, lysogenic, C, invasion, or D, protein production? All right, so the question is asking us pretty simply, what cycle is this describing symptoms in? And so we're looking for a virus cycle. That's the first thing. And so right away, we can eliminate C and D because these aren't cycles that we've heard of before. We're not going to waste time on them. These are discrete questions. They should be quicker. So right away, eliminate C and D. And we're down to lytic and lysogenic, the two most common viral cycle that we've learned about. So a lytic cycle, I like to think about, is sort of the fast break everything. Okay? And the lysogenic is sort of playing the long game. And so those are my two sort of descriptive factors. And with that, we should be able to pick B almost immediately. But let's go through it. Let's go make sure we understand the lytic and lysogenic. The lytic cycle is the virus comes in and sort of starts destroying the cell. It lyses the cell. Lytic comes from lyse. So lyse the cell, break it up. And then it likes to remake itself, remake virus progeny. And that's very, very important. It's taking the cell, breaking it up, and using the little bits and pieces and salvage and making more and more of itself. And so that's how it multiplies. The lysogenic is playing the long game, right? And so it's going to ingrain itself in host DNA, allow the cell to multiply normally, and then break cell with stress. Okay, so the idea is that sneakily just attaches itself to the host DNA, and the host thinks it's part of the normal DNA. So it's going to replicate with more and more cells, and all of a sudden we're going to have some sort of stress from environment, from whatever, that'll just cause everything to be chaos. All the cells are going to have that like code to say, all right, time to break. And so that's exactly what it is. It's an immediate sort of breakdown in a lytic cycle versus a longer term, okay, let's play the long game, multiply, snap. All of a sudden, bigger casualties in the longer term. And so with that, we see that the patient is not showing any respiratory symptoms or fever, right? Nothing's happening right now, so we're not expected to see the break everything. Everything's broken right now. More, we're focused on the long game, right? The virus is building its army. It's getting ready to attack. It doesn't need to attack yet. All right, y'all, we crushed five questions right there. Super, super helpful, discrete questions running everything from DNA modifications to genetics to ATP, all of that. So great job getting it done. Super, super challenging questions. If you like this video, give us a like down below and subscribe to our channel and comment exactly what videos you're looking for. Really helps us tailor this material for you guys. Additionally, check out our 528 series from Vikram. Super, super helpful strategies for all of the sections broken down and really, really help you achieve that dream score you're looking for. And finally, click the link in our bio to sign up for the MCAT question of the day so you don't miss out on any test prep before test day. Happy studying and let's get it.